Hello friends, this is Dr. Amit Ahuja, Assistant Professor, University School of Education, Guru Gobind Singh, Indraprastha University, Delhi. Friends, we are living in an information-dominated age and technology-oriented society. Things are the fingertips of a person and they can be assessed. We are in the grip of information. Things are growing exponentially. So what's the base of all this? How technology is supporting a society develop into a developed one? The answer is through sciences. Without science, a technology cannot be developed and it cannot be used for society. So what science is ultimately then? It's a literature of knowledge that is collected through observation and experimentation. See, it's not body of information. Literature in the sense some humanistic touch is there, in the sense that whatever the things are, whatever the surroundings are, have been explored by humans. Serendipity, that is accidental discovery, finds a very less space in sciences. For example, discovery of penicillin by Alexander Fleming is serendipity. But science does not proceed always on that. It works through observation and experimentation. Observation refers to careful seeing. It's not mere seeing that is using eye as a sense, but in a careful manner. Be cautious, don't be random, careless, etc. And experimentation, yes, of course, that is moving from known to unknown. However, this tendency of experimentation comprises practicals and activities under its umbrella. So without experimentation, you cannot go ahead in sciences. So wherever feasible things permit us, experimentation should be done. But when it's beyond our reach, things should be observed. How do they work? Because through experimentation, we come to know the working mechanism certain things. But through observation, we also come to know the working mechanism certain living things, etc. Then science for a modern society, us, has some definite function or purpose. What is the purpose of science teaching? Why science should be taught? Yes, science should be taught to create a personality that is capable of doing new things and is creative. Capable of doing new thing means the person must be innovative. That is, a sense of inquisitiveness should be there. How much better, to what extent better I can do into the existing system? How can I add on to the existing system? So the person must be capable of doing the new things. So for the thing to be capable, the first prerequisite is the person must be curious enough in nature. That's possible through our way of teaching the sciences. There must be difference between teaching of science and other subjects. Science cannot be narrated, science can be practiced. So when practiced in a true spirit in classroom, in laboratory, in outside nature also, then it puts my learner in an imaginative, in a state of imagination and cultivates a personality who becomes over a period of time capable of doing new things. Creative. Creative means bringing new things prior to its existence. That is, my learner is creative enough to make use of existing things, as and the solution or the thing coming ahead has never been existed. So that is devising something novel, new. Another purpose of science teaching is to put the learner in a state of inventive being. Is the learner able to invent the something new? That is, if the person is creative enough but cannot bring the things into existence, then it is useless. It is confined within cognition only. But if the things can be brought into the real practice or in the physical worlds by using the sources, the person is supposed to be inventive. All these inventions have been credited to science because of this tendency. Is the learner a discoverer? That is, ready to discover why it happens, how it happens, what it is, etc. So all these curious measures motivate the learner to be a discoverer. The tendency is, let us find it out. In at least science curriculum 3 decades ago, there used to be the things, let us do it, aao kuch kare, in the name of putting the learners in a state of discovery. But the things were quite ambiguous in the sense that they required very much sensitive, some specific material to discover. So hence, this spirit was dropped down over a period of time, because the putting them in a state of discoverer was not well supported by the presentation of the content in that textbook or the materials required to be a discoverer to discover the things. Then why to teach science? Because the science explores the world and interprets the world, which were the physical world, through its three major branches, that is physics, chemistry and biology, that it splits at senior secondary level and in these three domains, physics, chemistry and biology. What is physics then? Physics explores as a branch of science the energy and general properties of inanimate materials. What is energy level? What are its physical properties of any matter other than living beings? Chemistry. What is left for chemistry then? Then it explores the chemical properties of the same inanimate matter, because the general properties as physical properties have been explored by physics. Energy level has been explored by this. However, chemistry also explores the energy level of certain inanimate matter at micro level also, that is like orbitals, etc. What's biology? Biology, that means study of life, explores the behavior and properties of animate world. How does the world of living beings behaves? What are their properties? What are their features? All these pertain to the domain of biology as a sub-branch of sciences. Now the fundamental question is, if these are the three branches of sciences, why should we teach sciences? Yes, we should teach science because there is indispensable need to develop scientific method among my learners. The person equipped with, oriented with scientific method has at least ability to think. That means he does not accept the things as such. He raises questions. However, many times in classroom, we want to get rid of such tendencies among the learners, but kindly inculcate this, because his thinking is central to all learning processes. If there is no thinking, there is no learning. And thinking is indicated by a learner that the child questions. If the child doesn't question you, you motivate the child to question. For example, in teaching practices, in Bachelor of Education teacher level programs or in ordinary teaching classes at in-service level, whenever we close the chapter and we say, if you have to anything ask, kindly ask, the child says, no, it's okay. And we assume that complete learning on their part has taken place. No, it's not so. It's never so. Ask them to frame questions based on the content or the concept you taught just now. Now let them be in a position of examiner and you be as examinee, because when they frame the question, they will think, and whatever they retrieve, that can be assessed upon by you, because it's conceptually wrong or it is linguistically wrong. So that indicates the level of learning among the child, because the child may be present physically in my class, but mentally he, she may be anywhere in the world. There must be reasoning tendency among them. A person with scientific method must be able to reason the thing, why things happen so. Or if he or she is not able to find the reasons immediately, he or she must be motivated to do so. What is the reason for them? Let us find it out. Curiosity, yes. Curiosity at least puts you in an intrinsically motivated state. And I think it keeps you happy also. If not happy, puts you in some sort of positive stress that leads to knowledge exploration over the time also. So being dull, mute, dumb learner, it's better that my learner should be curious one. However, certain times this curiosity, when put through questions, many times it irritates, but we must acknowledge this with a positive spirit. If we are not able to satisfy the curiosity immediately, let it be after some time, but it should not be ignored upon. Open-mindedness, yes. You must be flexible enough. Don't be rigid in accepting the things. Because as the time passes on, we become mature, the experiences shadow our intelligence. who is an intelligent person, who is open-minded, ready to accept the things. But as we grow, our exposure, our experience dominate our personality and it sidelines the intelligence, because whatever we have to do, we look at our experience, what it has been so that's we will put that as our guiding light. But it should not be so. The person should be open-minded in the sense that he or she should be ready to work intelligently, okay, acknowledging the experiences to a great extent also, but the experiences should not be the guiding light in the sense that we become rigid. Then after that, why to teach science refers that we should inculcate scientific literacy amongst learners. It's another sub-branch of cognitive psychology that has been dwelled upon and is being dwelled upon by the researchers. But scientific literacy, that means enabling the learners to understand the nature of science, what it is, how does it differ from others. There should be difference between teaching of chemistry and history, but unfortunately we do so with the same spirit. So learners should understand the nature of science and what's the relationship between science, technology, society, that is STS approach. They support each other. Science is for society. If society does not acknowledge science, science would drop down. Technology leads to development of a society, but technology finds its roots in sciences. Science gives foundation for technology to grow, but technology in turn confirms sciences. What's technique then? Technique is something specific. But coming back to technology, I say that, for example, science is that photosynthesis on the part of plants, that is presence in the presence of sunlight they prepare their food. But technology is that what kind of apparatus you are using, that boiling tube, porcelain, thermometer, etc. So all these apparatuses are confirming that yes, photosynthesis is the process in which oxygen is liberated and oxygen supports combustion. So technology confirms science. So one depends upon other. A scientifically literate person must have good science background. It doesn't mean that you must be able to score 90%+ marks. No, you should have a rationalistic attitude and good understanding of scientific concept, principle, etc. Because if you lack that, at least you cannot go ahead with objectivity and open-mindedness. Then understand the nature of science. What science is? Like merely working on content and accepting them as such cannot put them as a learner of the discipline science, or cannot inculcate the spirit of scientific literacy amongst them. So we must realize what the nature of science is. Then the person must have positive attitude to science and technology. He or she is ready to accept the nature of science as such, that this is the nature of science and I have to work on that spirit. So directly jumping onto the conclusion like other subjects cannot work out in the science in a long way. Technology. Remember, technology is to support humans, but no technology can replace humans. Unfortunately, through internet, though I accept that, it provides some learning material, but all learning material cannot be reliable. Things in open domain are challengeable. No technology can replace a teacher. Unfortunately, again I say, when there is explosion of information and knowledge on websites, what role is left for us as a teacher? It is, if the trend continues, it rests only now to inculcate values among them, because that is not available on the internet. How to move towards value-oriented society, etc. This is left for a job for us if the trend continues. But the spirit like scientific literacy cannot be developed through internet. It can be developed by working, dwelling deep into arguments, debates, assertion, expression, negation, acceptance in classroom, with your peer, with your teacher. Then you have an attitude, and that over the period of time becomes positive also towards science and technology. Then scientific literacy also refers that the person is able to use scientific method. What is scientific method? Scientific method means study of a problem logically and systematically. That you are logical enough in your doing work and systematic, that means you are organized, you are not random, you are not haphazard. What is logical? Logical in that sense means, for example, aluminium, a metal, its atomic mass is 27, atomic number is 13. So what is the number of neutrons in aluminium? Now clearly see, atomic mass is a sum of nucleons. Nucleons refers to the particles present in the nucleus of an atom. Nucleons are protons and neutrons. They together constitute, their sum together constitutes atomic mass. But in an electrically neutral atom, the number of positive charges and number of electrically negative charges is equal. That is, number of proton is equal to number of electron. Another thing, atomic number refers to the number of protons in an atom. You see, the things present in the nucleus have been given due recognition. Now the particles surrounding the nucleus, that is electron, one is positively charged, that's why it has been credited as its atomic number of the atom. Another is neutral, but its summation with that positive charge leads to atomic mass. But again I say, electrically neutral is the atom. So if I know the number of electrons, suppose, then I can deduce its atomic number also. That is, number of protons, how much there are. So coming back to my question, how many number of neutrons are there? So that is atomic mass minus atomic number. That is proton plus neutron minus proton. So both the protons as positive and negatives cancel each other. I am left with neutron. So 27 minus 13 gives me 14. So 14 is the number of neutron in an atom of aluminium. Now this is logic that I adopted, that I use this mathematical operation while deducing this. There cannot be any other solution of this regarding the number of neutron. So this was logic. So person oriented with scientific method has logical tendency and is scientific methodological in nature. Scientific literacy develops science process skills among the learners. What do you mean by the term skills? Skills means potentials to act in certain ways. Kaushal, in Hindi it is said so. For example, everybody writes, has a definite handwriting, but the handwriting of a particular person is very beautiful. So that's a skill. So science process skills means, what are those different ways which help us in arriving at that knowledge, that body of knowledge? How has that arrived? So that doesn't mean that science can be conducted, performed, worked in laboratories, but it can be worked out in nature and in my classroom also. Like a scientist, our young learner can do that. So developing science process skills or the means or the ways to arriving at that problem, that body of knowledge. Scientific literacy helps me in better understanding of the world, the phenomena happening inside and outside, rather than tagging them as curse or some associated with some ill omens. The people come to know about what the phenomena is, why it is happening so, like certain calamities, natural calamities. Otherwise they used to be referred to the curse or anger of God, but actually it was the misdeeds of humans that leads to so like global warming. Why there is so much stretching of summers in a state like Delhi? Because of overuse of these electrical appliances, that's why it is so. So better understanding of the world emphasizes the person able to probe the reason behind a happening. Appreciation of a value of science for society. Yes, science is for society. If science is not for society, then at least it's not a science. Science helps a society to grow, develop, drift from developing society to developed society. The society who are at the developed end of the continuum definitely have been grown through the process of scientific literacy. Then why to teach science? It requires to develop a true perception for science, in the sense that science should be treated, taught as a part of culture. It's integral to our living and our thinking also. It does not grow in a vacuum, in isolation. Science grows in the society, amongst the humans. So that's the nature of science. Science is a way of exploring the world, not accepting the world as such. Unless and until you don't question the world, you are not able to explore. It inculcates a spirit of inquiry among the learner, so that they are motivated to explore why the things are so. Science is a means of attaining learning experiences. don't worry about the negative results. Focus upon the process. Negative finding is also a finding. Negative results are also negatives. So that's the objectivity of sciences. That this much result fails in one situation also, but this much result is successful in 10 situations. What is that one situation in which it got failed? Now becomes a matter to explore. So that's the beauty of sciences. Science is linked with society and technology. Yes, as said previously also, science adds on to the society, leads to its development. Science is based on technology. Technology in turn confirms technology, but the difference is that technology is just like a mule which cannot breed on its cell phone, but sciences can through technology. Then after that, we need to emphasize a collaboration between science, technology and society. None of them can grow in isolation. So friends, let's now summarize what we have learned so far. What is science then? Science is a body of knowledge that is collected through observation and experimentation. That means science takes place beyond laboratories also, that is in nature, in classroom, everywhere in surrounding, and that is visible through observation. Purpose of science teaching emphasizes to develop a personality that is capable of doing new things and is creative, inventive and discoverer. Such personality works with scientific method, that is works logically and sequentially, not haphazardly. Such personality has scientific literacy, that is able to address the societal issues with the help of sciences. Sees a continuous thread, a continuum between science, technology and societies. All these confirm together each other. Nothing grows in isolation. Thank you very much.